Have you ever wondered why the news plays the same five stories again and again? Let me give you a little hint. Brainwashing and repetition is the most basic form of brainwashing. Join me as we look at the news cycle and talk about why the mainstream media is so gutless and afraid to report the truth. What is going on? Happy Monday. Welcome to Troubled Minds News. I'm your host, Michael Strange, and this is the show where the conspiracy is the news. That's right, it's the news. And what that means is propaganda, misinformation, disinformation, what living in a post-truth world actually means anymore. And that's what's up. That's what we do on this show. This little news segment dealio for about an hour started on Troubled Minds Radio, if you guys remember that old show. Actually, it's still going. It's not an old show. But in the old days on Troubled Minds Radio, we actually used to do an entire news segment. It just got larger and larger, more and more news, and it started taking over the show. So, well, here we are, a whole new show for just the news, and just for transparency purposes, and just for being part of this. Well, we got a phone number, and if you want to call and be part of the conversation at any point, you can dial this phone number, 702-957-1037. That's 702-957-1037, and we'll put you on the show. It's as simple as that. Let's see. What do we got? Recent press about blah, blah, blah. I'm getting emails about Lord knows what. Anyway, what's going on, guys? Hope everybody's well today. Happy Monday. Remember, Monday doesn't suck. It is your job that sucks. And so that's what we do today. That's what we talk about, to the news and all the rest of this stuff. And don't mind the clock. That little clock, don't worry about it, little guy. All right, let's do it. Let's do the thing. 702-957-1037. Click the Discord link, troubledminds.org, if you want to be part of the show, watching the phone line, and, of course, the Discord as well. Let's get to it. Let's get to the big news today, the UFO news from Politico. Yeah, the UFO briefings on Capitol Hill have begun. Oh, all right. Now we're in business, right? Now the people that has, like, the lowest approval rating ever of anything ever, like, what, 9% or something, 9% approval rating on Capitol Hill. That would be our Congress there. And, now they're, UFO briefings. Oh, and the lawmakers aren't impressed. What does that tell you? What does that mean? What does that even mean? This is written by Brian Bender, who gets a lot of guff in the UFO community because he, you know, wants to report on real things and, you know, kind of not UFOs. And anyway, if you follow the drama, everybody's always pissed off at each other because you say things that piss people off. And, you know, the UFO community, just go get on UFO Twitter and you'll know what I'm talking about. You'll go hashtag UFO Twitter some things, and pretty soon somebody else will do it. STFU. You'll see. Anyway, so let's read some of this. Members of the Senate Intelligence and Armed Services Committees received classified progress reports in recent weeks on a series of new data collection efforts the Pentagon and spy agencies are now required to pursue to more rigorously investigate reports of UFOs. Three people with a direct knowledge confirmed. There you go. What's up, Derek? Monday's my Friday, so the living's easy. Oh, hell yeah. This continues. But some leading sponsors of recent legislation want more analysts and surveillance systems dedicated to determining the aircraft's origin, and not just more reports of their existence. Hey, why not, right? Like, why not? Let's find out where the hell the UFOs are coming from, and, you know, who's flying these things, anything at all, instead of, you know, yeah, we know they're here, right? We know they're here. We know, we've been talking about this. People see lights in the damn sky all the damn time. So what is their origin? I think that's a hell of a question. Why not? One of those lawmakers is Senator Kirsten Gillibrand, a Democrat of New York, a member of both committees, who has called the phenomena an urgent issue and for the first time is expressing her public dissatisfaction to the response. Quote, Senator Gillibrand believes that the DOD needs to take this issue much more seriously and get in motion, end quote, said one of her aides who requested anonymity in order to discuss private conversations. Continue, quote, here, they have had ample time to implement these important provisions, and they need to show us that they are prepared to address this issue in the long term. What does that mean? What does that mean? Address the issue and the UFO issue in the long term. What does that mean? Does that mean more funding? What the hell does this mean? Anyway, the congressional briefings come 4 months after Congress passed the National Defense Authorization Act, requiring the Pentagon to create the Anomaly Surveillance and Resolution Office. Okay. The office, which is supposed to be fully operational by June, was granted the authority to pursue any resource, capability, asset, or process to investigate unidentified aerial phenomena, with the now widely accepted nomenclature for UFOs. All right. So what does this even mean? I don't know. Look, we talked about this in the past. Is this whole just the UFO stuff just a big shtick to get more war funding, to fund the Pentagon, the DOD? I don't know. Some people think that's the case. Other people think, no, the aliens are here. I don't know. What do you think? It doesn't matter what I think. It matters what you think. Like I said, it's your reality. Look, I'll handle my reality. You handle your reality, okay? And I don't know. I don't have those answers, but it sure seems to me that if we're going to be doing these briefings on Capitol Hill, that maybe something should come out of it, right? Something? Anything? I don't know. You tell me. 702-957-1037. Click the Discord link at troubledminds.org. Let's get back to Earth for just a moment. Well, the Capitol Hill is kind of not Earth, I guess. Oh, and let me link that first one, the Politico article as well, so you guys can check it out because transparency and all that. All right, here we go. Look at this. This is from News 3 Las Vegas. Yeah, wouldn't you know it? This is the state of the world right now. Three men accused of stealing 10,000 gallons of fuel in Las Vegas. Yeah, that's where I live, Las Vegas. 10,000 gallons. Three men have been arrested for allegedly stealing more than 10,000 gallons of fuel from Las Vegas gas stations, according to authorities. The Las Vegas Review-Journal reports that according to court records, Radel Amador Blanco, Luis Gomez Madero, and Javier Ramos Gomez are each facing charges of theft and conspiracy. Yeah, there's your conspiracy. Las Vegas Metro Police said that the three men allegedly altered their trucks and the sensors at a gas pump, to steal about 9,900 gallons of diesel fuel from a Chevron station on April 7th. Was this 99 gallons of gas on the wall? 99 gallons of gas. An employee called police to report that the station was short about 1,500 gallons of fuel in the past 24 hours, and also found security footage that showed two trucks parked at the pump for hours. Huh, that's bizarre that nobody noticed that at the time. Authorities said the losses totaled more than $8,000. Okay, I'm not very good at math, but okay, how do we get 9,900 gallons? That's 9,900 gallons of gas, and the losses totaled more than $8,000. Are we like $1.15 per gallon gas? What is this? Is this the wholesale cost of gas? Because if they're getting charged $1.15 and we're paying like $5.50, I got a bone to pick. What the hell's, what is with this? Okay, the headline says stealing 10,000 gallons. This one says 9,900 gallons. And then it says totaling more than $8,000. What? Come on now. I'm a little mad at this just because, well, I mean, you know, their ingenuity, let them have it, whatever. But now they're going to jail. But in any case, 10,000 gallons of fuel stolen. That's pretty hot sitting there, right? the truck sitting there for hours. Now, that's a big truck, by the way. If you imagine rolling in like a huge fuel truck and you're like, just put the pump in and just let it roll and you're there for hours. nobody like comes by, like the clerks inside, and nobody notices. This is weird. What's up, Ranger Red? If you're there on Discord, I saw you just pop in there. Brand new Discord user, either a spook or a friend, who knows. You can't hardly tell the difference anymore. 702-957-1037. Would you notice if you were working at the gas station if somebody was at the pump for like hours at a time. Anyway, let's continue, shall we? Let's go to space. Let's get off of this dirty, dirty Earth, and let's go to space. The final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starship Troubled Minds. No, I'm just kidding. Space.com. Star Wars-style hyperdrive might produce a quantum glow, not star streaks. There it is. Physicists are on the hunt for the UNRWA effect, also known as quantum glow. What's up, APOC? If anybody wants to send good healing thoughts and energy, not feeling well, please do. Everybody give a moment of positive energy to our good friend APOC there. Sorry you're not feeling well. That is not good. It is Monday, and hopefully Tuesday will be better for you. Hang in there, my friend. What do we got? This is pretty cool. If you guys have seen this, you know, when they go into hyperspace in Star Wars, they got the stars streaking by, right? Like the stars just kind of like, right? But apparently, let's say scientifically, if they actually had a warp drive, they're saying that wouldn't be the case at all. There's something called a quantum glow. A quantum glow. What the hell is that, right? That's cool. The view from the iconic Millennium Falcon of Star Wars during hyperdrive maneuvers would be far different than what science fiction portrays, scientists say. Rather than the iconic star streaks, we'd see a glow, either due to quantum fluctuations that would be subatomic, as a new study proposes, or in previous work, perhaps due to the Doppler effect shifting the visible wavelengths of stars into the X-ray range. Of course, absent a hyperdrive-equipped ship, it's going to be difficult to prove the glow theory, despite the fact that the quantum fluctuation idea dates to the 1970s. What? Really? But now a new study proposes a way to finally see the quantum phenomenon in action, perhaps allowing scientists to simulate the so-called UNRWA effect every few hours, if all goes well. Yeah. Punch it, Chewy. Punch it. Quote, now at least we know there is a chance in our lifetimes where we might actually see this effect, study co-author Vivek Sudhir, assistant professor of mechanical engineering at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, said in a university statement. Sudhir evoked Princess Leia's famous plea to Obi-Wan Kenobi, "You're our only hope," when talking about the difficult work still facing his team. "It's a hard experiment, and there's no guarantee that we'd be able to do it, but this idea is our nearest hope." The UNRWA effect, formerly known as the Fulling-Davies UNRWA effect, states that a body moving swiftly through the vacuum of space should feel warm radiation as a result of the acceleration. The radiation would come from quantum interactions and fluctuations in space, according to the statement. But to see this effect at the atomic level, an atom would have to accelerate to the speed of light in less than a millionth of a second. And here's a good representation of what this would look like. Here's your quantum glow, which seems to be like a, I don't know, like a nice gradient made in Photoshop. Very nice. Very nice. Very nice. And punch it, Chewy. Photoshop turns on. What's happening, guys? Hope everybody's well. APAC, sorry to hear about that. That is terrible. I'm not sure. Let me know if I can do anything for you. How about that? I'll leave it at that. 702-957-1037. Click the Discord link, troubledminds.org. We'll put you on the show. It's as easy as that. What do you think about Star Wars? What do you think about stealing 10,000 gallons of gas? And what about the UFO briefings on Capitol Hill? Not a bad start to the news for the day. Hey, let's do one more, and then we'll take a quick break and get a word from our sponsor, which of course is you. Speaking of space, let's stay in space for just a moment. Speaking of the quantum glow, quantum glow sounds like a weed strain. what's up, Night Stalker? Here you go. LiveScience.com reports this. The universe could stop expanding remarkably soon, study suggests. And this is piping hot news, published about 10 hours ago. So there you go. There you go. In just 100 million years, the universe could start to shrink, new research suggests. Yeah, okay, so after nearly 13.8 billion years of non-stop expansion, that's the, of course, 13.8 billion is, they think the universe is about that old. It's been expanding since the singularity and the Big Bang and all the rest of that. The universe could soon grind to a standstill, then slowly start start to contract. New research published in the journal Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences suggests. Uh-oh, are we nearing the end, guys? In the new paper, three scientists attempt to model the nature of dark energy, a mysterious force that seems to be causing the universe to expand ever faster based on past observations of cosmic expansion. In the team's model, dark energy is not a constant force of nature, but an entity called quintessence. Yes, which can decay over time. Quintessence, that's a t-shirt right there. The researchers have found that even though the expansion of the universe has been accelerating for billions of years, the repellent force of dark energy may be weakening. According to their model, the acceleration of the universe could rapidly end within the next 65 million years. Well, let's hope they don't find a way to let us live forever, right? I digress. Then, within 100 million years, the universe could stop expanding altogether, and instead, it could enter an era of slow contraction that ends billions of years from now with the death, or perhaps the rebirth, of time and space. What's up, Gibby? Is this why stars are disappearing from the sky? That's a good question. That's an interesting one as well. I don't know. So here we go. They say, and all this could happen remarkably quickly, said the study co-author Paul Steinhard, director of the Princeton Center for Theoretical Science at Princeton University in New Jersey. Quote, going back in time 65 million years, that's when the Chicxulub asteroid hit the Earth and eliminated the dinosaurs, Steinhard told Live Science. On a cosmic scale, 65 million years is remarkably short. And energy of the void since the 1990s, blah, blah, so on and so forth, blah, blah. Anyway, all right. So we got some time. So it's not going to be tonight. You guys make sure you pop open the cold ones, fire up the spliffs if it's legal in your jurisdiction and you're of age, of course. And there you go. 702-957-1037. Click the Discord link, troubledminds.org. We'll put you on the show. It's as easy as that. But we're going to take a quick break and get a word from our sponsor, which is you. Don't go anywhere. Be right back. More Troubled Minds on the way with yours truly. That's right, Michael Strange. Are you digging the show? If so, you can support us quite easily and at no additional cost to you if you already have an Amazon Prime account. Since we stream on Twitch every day, all you have to do is link your Amazon Prime account to your Twitch account, and they give you free games on a monthly basis for your personal use, and also a bonus $5 a month to send to your favorite streamer as a way to bring more people to Twitch. And all you have to do is sync up the two accounts and click subscribe. Thanks for considering.
All right. Welcome back to Troubled Minds News. I'm your host, Michael Strange. Let's keep on trucking, shall we? There's always great news here. Let's go to CNN, the most trusted source in news. And right. The dinosaur analogy, right? 65 million years ago, things got really bad. 65 million years from now, things are also going to get really bad. Coming soon to a theater near you. The end of the universe. CNN reports. Inside the Space Hotel, scheduled to open in 2025. What? Yeah, you hear that? Space Hotel. Okay, all right. This should be fine. Let's see. The waking up in a chic hotel room with a view of the solar system could be the future of travel, at least if space company Orbital Assembly has anything to say about it. Orbital Assembly. That's great, right? The U.S.-based company has revealed new information and concepts for its space hotel idea, designs for which have been orbiting since 2019. Orbiting. These guys. Originally premiered by Californian company The Gateway Foundation and then called the Von Braun Station. This futuristic concept consists of several modules connected by elevator shafts that make up a rotating wheel orbiting the Earth. The project is now being overseen by Orbital Assembly Corporation, a space construction company that cut links with Gateway. Orbital Assembly is now aiming to launch not one, but two space stations with tourist accommodation. Voyager Station, the renamed original design, is now scheduled to accommodate 400 people and to open in 2027. Now, while the new concept Pioneer Station, housing 28 people, could be operational in just 3 years. Are you kidding me? Is this for real? I mean, the Matt Damon movie, right? What was the, where they move them to the space station because the Earth is polluted? What is this, right? This is crazy. Anyway, the goal, says Orbital Assembly, is to run a space business park, home to offices as well as tourists. Huh.
This should be fine. Space tourism seems closer than ever before. Blah, 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 blah. Here we go. Let's see. The goal, quote, the goal has always been to make it possible for large amounts of people to live, work, and thrive in space, Altori told CNN Travel in a new interview. That's Tim Altori, Orbital Assembly's chief operating officer, and he thinks that this barrier will lift as space tourism takes off. So Altori says that the concept of the new Pioneer Station is that its smaller scale makes it achievable sooner. Quote, it's going to get us the opportunity to have people start to experience space on a larger scale faster, he said. The office spaces and research facilities will also end up for rent on both Pioneer Station and Voyager Station. Star Trek Voyager? That seems fine, right? This is all good. This is all good. Anyway, in a 2019 interview with CNN Travel, Altori explained the physics of Voyager Station as working like a spinning bucket of water. All right, that's cool. I mean, what is that Matt Damon movie? What is that? God, I always forget the name. It's on the tip of my tongue. Anyway, they move them up to the space station because Earth is so dirty and polluted. Only the poor, nasty people live down here, and all the rich people go up to space where they get the med beds and they live forever and all the rest of that, right? That's where Congress will be. They'll be in one of these things, right? With all of the amenities of a luxury hotel 24/7 and some Night Stalk shells in space, honestly. Have to change your name. The Night Space Stalker. I don't know. I mean, this seems cool. They're saying that they're scheduled to open in 2025. Like Elysium. Yes, thank you, Often Frozen. Appreciate that. That's the movie. I can never remember the damn name of that movie. It's always on the tip of my tongue, and I just can't remember it. Elysium's a fantastic name, by the way. But there you go. 2025. They got two of them, the Voyager and the Pioneer space stations that are going to be happening. That's super fast, right? Yeah, 2025. That makes no damn sense. What are your thoughts? 702-957-1037. Click the Discord link at troubleminds.org. Put you on the show. It's as easy as that. And boom, 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 boom. More. Look at this. This is pretty wild. If you guys didn't see this, we'll file this under Giggle Fest. Russian troops stole $5 million worth of farm vehicles from a John Deere dealership, which remotely locked the thieves out of the equipment. Suckers. Okay. All right. Business Insider. Yep. Let's see. Russian troops occupying the Ukrainian city of Melitopol, is that how you say that, stole nearly $5 million of farm vehicles from a John Deere dealership and shipped some of them more than 700 miles away to Chechnya, CNN reported, only to find they had been rendered useless by a remote locking system that prevented the thieves from turning the equipment on. Two compound harvesters valued at $300,000 each, as well as 27 other tractors, seeders, and additional pieces of equipment were stolen from the dealership. But the remote access technology of the equipment, which allows for GPS tracking and some of the vehicles to be remotely operated, prevented them from being used. Quote, when the invaders drove the stolen harvesters to Chechnya, they realized they could not even turn them on because the harvesters were locked remotely, a source familiar with the incident told CNN. While the equipment could still be scrapped and sold for parts by Russian troops, the source said it is currently lying idle on a farm near Grozny, Grozny. let's see. There you go. That's probably a good way to wind that one up. Get wrecked. Get wrecked. This is how you actually get owned by John Deere. But why not, right? Remote start is not working, I guess. Here we go. This is a pretty good one. This is for all you dreamers out there. This one goes out to all you fine folks that just can't stop dreaming. Just kidding. Bigthink.com. Your personality is linked to risk of dementia and cognitive decline. What? All right. Yeah. I was reading this article, and this is pretty fascinating. It's very, very long, so I'm not going to get you into the way this starts out because it's a little bit boring. But here you go. A new study from the American Psychological Association, published in the Journal of Personality and Social Psychology, suggests that certain personality traits also affect the cognitive decline of
of older adults. Led by author Tomiko Yonida from the University of Victoria, the researchers found that individuals with high conscientiousness were much less likely to develop dementia. Further, they had more capacity to recover from moderate impairment. Neurotic individuals, people more prone to stress and worry, were more likely to plunge into cognitive decline and to stay there. What? The researchers leveraged data from nearly two decades of annual assessments taken on nearly 2,000 older adults to estimate the association between personality traits and the risk of cognitive decline. This model structure allowed the researchers to assess the entire pathway of cognitive impairment. It provided new insights on how the progression of each stage influences the other and how personality might play a role in regulating all of it. So wouldn't you know it, as you would expect, right? I mean, you know, if is this your universal karma? Or whatever's going on with this, meaning that if you be a nice person, well, you'll be healthier longer. Isn't that strange? Isn't that a novel idea? That maybe the universe works in mysterious ways, and in the case of being kind to others around you, now something else to worry about. Damn it, Robert. No, I would say you're a pretty good dude. So I don't, as far as I can tell, you don't have much to worry about, my friend. But this is exactly one of those ones that it seems to make sense. Is this the cosmic karma sort of doing its thing, making it known that, hey, if you be an asshole, the universe will just kill you off faster, right? Maybe. It seems kind of like something like that. I don't know. You tell me. 702-957-1037. Let's keep on trucking. We got this one. This is from neuroscience news.com. Yeah, that's right. This is pretty cool. Speaking of brain stuff, look at this. This is a high static magnetic field can relieve anxiety. Ah, here's another way to relieve the anxiety, right? We talked about mushrooms and whatnot before, but this is pretty cool. Let's see. For the first time reported, the biosafety of, 30 T-level SMF and the neurobehavioral effects on healthy mice in the Journal of Magnetic Resonance Imaging and European Radiology. Based on previously biosafety, blah, blah, blah. Okay. After exposure, all mice were routinely fed for 2 months. After the few metabolic and liver and hepatorenal function, I don't know if that's the right word, indicators affected by magnetic field, the whole blood count, organ coefficient, and histomorphology of main organs were not seriously affected, and most of them were still within the normal reference range. Oh, okay, so if we just blast these little rats and mice with a magnetic field, their organs don't fail. That's a good start. That's a hell of a start, right? Meanwhile, behavioral tests showed that high SMF alleviated anxiety and improved social and spatial memory in mice within 2 months after exposure. In addition, behavioral studies of healthy mice exposed to 3.5 to 23.0 T magnetic field for 2 hours also found improved neurocognitive effects, which may be associated with increased calcium, calmodulin-dependent protein, kinase, I don't know what this word is, I'm not a scientist, sorry, kinase 2 expression in the mouse hippocampus, I know that word. Zhang's group further found that 7-TSMF, which is a level of magnetism there, could relatively relieve symptoms of depressed mice. These studies not only provide useful safety information for the development of ultra-high MRI, but also indicate that high SMF has the potential to be a future antidepressant treatment. Ah, there we go. In mice, as always, right? They say that this stuff is fine and it's good and, you know, it won't destroy your organs or anything. But, you know, it's always in mice, right? Don't forget the caveat. They say it's people, but it's in mice. Yeah, right? What's going on? What's going on? They keep a nodidium magnet in my pillow at night? For real? For real? Yeah, what's up, James? Can't let a potential weapon go to waste, huh? Night Stalker, if it can relieve anxiety, I'm sure it could be tweaked and cause anxiety, right? Maybe some people are getting hit by waves now. You don't say. You don't say. That's the scalar wave. You remember that guy used to call into Clyde Lewis all the time? He was like the inside source. He called him with like the serial killer voice scrambler. He was like, I used to work at Area 51 or whatever this other thing. And he always talked about scalar waves and how they were using. Anyway, I digress. 702-957-1037. Click the Discord link, troubledminds.org. Maybe.
Maybe. Maybe. Where are we time-wise? I think everything is fine. We're all fine here. Now, let's do one more, and then we'll take another quick break and get a word from our sponsor, which, of course, is you. And let's roll it. Here we go. This is from Gizmodo. Yep. Mm-hmm. The Facebook papers. We're publishing the Facebook papers. Here's what they say about the ranking algorithms that control your news feed. What do you think they say, guys? What do you think they say? Of course, they can't just, like, you know, they link to it, but they got to, you know, blah, 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 blah. These journalists, just give us the damn paragraph that's pertinent, please. Anyway, they're talking about ranking, right? So the presentation is part of the Facebook papers, blah, blah. They're talking about some of the stuff pulled out. It's a blah, 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 blah. Today's batch offers insight into how Meta chooses to rank the content submitted by its users. It's a system that very people seem to understand, a problem the company appears short on clues how to solve. Choosing these documents as a follow-up to ones on the most political events of the past 2 years speaks to how highly we consider their relevance to understanding Facebook's effects on the world. Blah, blah, blah. Several key documents concern what Facebook calls, now this is the interesting part, right? Facebook calls these meaningful social interactions. All right, let's see what they did. Meaningful, a term introduced by the company in January of 2018. This metric, as CEO Mark Zuckerberg explained at the time, was meant to help prioritize personal connections over an endless online dribble of viral news and videos. This major change, as he put it, was framed as an effort to put first the happiness and health of the user. Happiness and health of the user. Mm-hmm. Sure. Interesting how they consider that to be a priority when it doesn't seem to be that quite at all. Anyway, Facebook's way of encouraging users to check Facebook more often by dialing up the feeling of personal connection to their feeds. What constitutes, now this is where it starts to get Orwellian, what constitutes a meaningful social interaction, you may wonder? Yeah, Meta's phrasing seems intentionally opaque. It could be sharing a cold beer with an old friend or maybe a meal with a whole family under the same roof. To Facebook, it's a math problem, a way of training a computer to assign some degree of worth to the most benign online behaviors. Putting a sticker, for instance, on a random weirdo's post. Anyway, we know this. This is nothing new, but it is interesting that the Facebook papers are out and they're available. And I haven't spent a ton of time reading these things. I was just like, whatever. Duh. Like I've been saying, I was saying this a long time before anybody was acknowledging it. You guys know me. I've been all over this shit for a long ass time. If you've been listening for a long ass time, you know. And so Facebook, middle finger to you, my friends, or not so friends, my meta friends. How about that? 702-957-1037. Click the Discord link, troubledminds.org. And we're going to bounce and get another quick word from our sponsor, which is you. Remember, if you do sub up on Twitch and you're doing it with Amazon Prime, it's easy to forget, but it does need to be re-upped every month or it will fall off. So I appreciate that very much. Thanks to those of you that have done that and also supported and subbed up on Twitch here as well. So you're listening to Troubled Minds News. I'm your host, Michael Strange. Don't go anywhere. More after the break. Be right back. Welcome back to Troubled Minds News. I'm Michael Strange. Let's continue. Let's keep on trucking, shall we? There's always more news. Let's go to Mars. Let's get out of the meta jerks. What's up, Gibby? Meta jerks, maybe, for sure. For sure. Mars is this. This is pretty hot, right? These dry ice glaciers on Mars are moving at its south pole. I wonder if there's a dry ice dune worms under there somewhere. Anyway, carbon dioxide glaciers on Mars are a fast-flowing phenomena. A new study finds that dry ice flows closer to 100 times faster than water ice in the thin atmosphere on Mars when on high slopes. Researchers verified this process looking at carbon dioxide glaciers in the south polar region of Mars and say modeling suggests this movement could have been going on for the past 600,000 years. It's a long time. Studies like this have implications for understanding ice formation across the solar system. Earth, Mars, and Pluto are verified locations for fast-flowing ice, but the nonprofit Planetary Science Institute in Arizona stated this number likely will increase. Okay. All right. That seems fine, right? The super fast flowing dry ice on Mars. This is fine. Now, quote, numerous types of ice exist in the solar system, and with the count of dwarf planets increasing, it's likely that some of them will have glaciers of carbon monoxide or methane, even more exotic than the dry ice glaciers just discovered on Mars, the Institute said. Sweet. Anybody like to ski? This should be fun. Now, the dry ice has increased both in volume and in mass since it first formed more than half a billion years ago, although the process was periodically interrupted, quote, by periods of mass loss through sublimation, lead author Isaac Smith, a PSI research scientist, said in the same statement. Sublimation, of course, means the direct transformation of ice into gas, which is also, by the way, Rob brought up Oumuamua the other night on the Discord. Now, sublimation is another interesting thing that made Oumuamua different than many other things in the solar system. But anyway, if the ice had never flowed, Smith said, then it would mostly be where it was originally deposited, and the thickest ice would be about 45 meters thick. Instead, because it flowed downhill into basins and spiral troughs, curvy linear basins, they call it, I guess, where it ponded, it was able to form deposits reaching 1 kilometer thick. All right, I guess this is fine. Fast in planetary terms is not that fast. It's not that fast. What's up, Bernays? How you doing? Whole universe heating up? Maybe. Maybe. Universal warming. Let's go to Yahoo News. Let's keep on trucking, shall we? 702-957-1037. Click the Discord link at troubleminds.org. I thought this is pretty nice. Yahoo did one on this, and we talk about this often, right? This is from the Washington Post to Yahoo News. The long and gruesome history of people trying to live forever. I love this. So immortality might seem like the stuff of science fiction, yet it's increasingly becoming a focus of real science. In 2013, Google launched Calico, a biotech firm whose objective is to solve death. PayPal co-founder Peter Thiel, meanwhile, has pledged to fight death. And last year, it was reported Amazon chairman Jeff Bezos had invested in Altos Labs, a company that plans to rejuvenate cells in order to reverse disease. There's even a startup developing drugs so that dogs can live longer. Now we're talking. Now we're in business, guys. Clinical trials are scheduled to start this year. If they're conclusive, the plan is to apply the same science to people. This is fine. How could this go wrong? Immortality, as researchers, anti-aging, as researchers soberly call it, is the next big thing. Estimates put the industry's worth at a staggering $610 billion by 2025. Isn't that the best way to measure things? Not by success, but by dollars. I love it. I just love it so much. From Silicon Valley to Cambridge, England, scientists are writing the latest chapter in the torturous history of our quest for eternal life. It's a history that goes back a long way. We've been trying forever to live forever. Our species' oldest story, the Epic of Gilgamesh, is about that very longing. Etched on clay tablets 4 millennia ago in Mesopotamia, it concerns King Gilgamesh, a wild bull of a man with gigantic muscles and an even more gigantic ego. After the death of his best friend, Gilgamesh is forced to confront his own mortality. "Must I die too?" he cries to the heavens. Interesting. This is a pretty good article. I do recommend it if you are into this sort of thing. It's fun. Let's live forever, shall we? How could this go wrong, right? Definitely file this under how could this go wrong. They're going to try it in dogs coming up, and then after that, well, take the anti-aging shot, right? take the shot. Don't make me say it. All right, give me just 1 sec, and we'll keep on trucking. More news on the way. Let's see. Actually, I think I'm okay. I was about to sneeze. The crisis abated. Let's go to lifehacker.com. Yes, indeed. This article was written by AI. Robert's got it right. Just rich people. Speaking of living forever, right? Just the rich people. Just the people that get the med beds on the space stations, right? Those are going to be the people that... there you go. Copymatic uses artificial intelligence to create content and to come for my job, says this individual, Meredith Dietz, written today at 3:30 p.m. This is hot off the press. Of course, you know me. I like to have a piping hot news because, well, if it's not, then it's not news, is it? There you go. Is your job safe from artificial intelligence? As a writer who depends on finding the right words for my own thoughts, I foolishly believed I might be relatively robot-proof. Turns out with AI copywriting sites like Copymatic, I was dead wrong. I like to hope there are some areas of uniquely human creativity that can't be produced by AI quite yet. That's why I take comfort in things like the first stand-up comedy special written entirely by bots, which was made by a bot watching over 400,000 hours of stand-up and then writing its own special. My favorite joke from the special is probably, beep, beep, I am a microwave. I dropped out of oven college. Beep. Ah, yeah, there we go. That's super, super, super hot. Unfortunately, every word I'm writing right now will be used against me. I'm going to plug this introduction into Copymatic, which claims to generate unique and human-like content in seconds. All right, so let's scroll down. Basically, this author, Meredith Dietz, dropped this intro, this top part that I was reading into this Copymatic to see if they would finish. Well, and here's the AI, what the AI actually finished. Listen to this. What is a Copymatic? This is all written by AI. Copymatic is a tool that uses artificial intelligence to help you write better articles. It analyzes your writing and provides feedback to help you improve your style, grammar, and vocabulary. How does it work? The blog section for this article was written by AI is quite simple. It features a short introduction to the article itself and then allows readers to leave comments and questions. There's also a link to the full article so that readers can explore it further. What are the benefits of using Copymatic? There are many benefits using Copymatic, including Copymatic can help you create unique content for your blog or website. The software can help you save time by automatically generating articles for you. You can use Copymatic to create content in any language, and the software can help you improve your writing skills by providing feedback on your work. There's more here, but that didn't sound very it sounds like AI speaks English as a first language. Let's just say that, because this is pretty amazing. Wow. I wouldn't call it like Anne Rice or anything style writing, but it's definitely to the point. I don't know. What do you think? Can I call in about something, John Deere? Yeah, 702-957-1037. Love to hear it, man. What's up, Joseph? I see you there, buddy. Let's see. We got another one, and then we'll take Joseph's call. If you're going to pop in here, you can jump on Discord or call the phone number. It's up to you. Let's see. Let's do this. Oh, this is pretty hot. This is, let's see, let me make sure I got that up. Okay. All right. Got them both up. So if you jump in there, I'll be able to, I'll see you. This is from IFLScience.com. And that's, of course, IFreakingLoveScience.com, right? IFL. Incredible animation shows the actual scale of our solar system, all right? And this is the best part here. I'm going to make this here so we don't get copyright blipped. But this is pretty hot. Let's see. What's the size? Let's see. Sun. No, they moved it. They had the other one embedded right here. Now it's not. Let's do the Twitter. All right, here we go. Anyway, that'll work. All right, here's the size of. Oh, not the flat earth. Damn it. Come on. Okay. Anyway, I guess that's probably. They put the flat earth in. Okay, anyway, you get the idea, right? They're putting the sizes of the Earth is about the same size as Venus roughly, and there you go. It's pretty hot. It's like the solar system to scale and kind of a backdrop by the sun there. Pretty good stuff. The link's in the description if you want to check it out full screen yourself. I thought it was pretty fantastic, but it's not actually the flat earth version. It's like the real earth version, which is super hilarious. Anyway, 702-957-1037. And we're going to go to, let's go to Joseph in Iowa. What's up, my friend? Welcome to Troubled Minds. Go right ahead. What's on your mind, my man?
Yo, so you were talking about John Deere factory, and I live in a town that actually has like the biggest John Deere. Or you were talking about someone stealing John Deere's. I live in a place that has the factory, one of the biggest, or it is the biggest casting building in the world, at least that we know of. Like, I'm sure China has something up their sleeve, or like one of the mother countries, but like there's like, I know this, they went on strike, right? And it triggered me to have major dreams because I saw people with flaming barrels, those big old trash can barrels. They were picketing or whatever with the signs and stuff. It was something out of a movie, man. It was crazy. But they have these sandblasters that they made salary people, right? That's how you know, like, some of these CEO companies or some of these big corporations are kind of headless. They were making these office people, like my uncle was one of them. He's an engineer. They made him go into the sandblaster unit to cover for people who were picketing, right? Because they were trying to get higher wages and better benefits and stuff. And these sandblasters will literally pick a 150-pound person off the ground. Like, if you're like a girl, like, it's impossible to do this job because, like, they have these sandblasters. They shoot sand so fast out of a hose that it will pick you up off the ground. It's legit. Like,
yeah,
and they've had people.
They've had
people like lose grip of that hose, and that thing will fly around. And like there was one guy. I heard a story. He committed suicide actually because there was so much sand embedded into his skin. Like some of these factories. I mean, they're not human, dude. These things, I mean, there's the size of a lot, the size of a commercial lot. I'm talking about 2 acres is just one giant 3D, basically printer for, it's not printer, it's casting. They can cast entire tanks. You know, they have blueprints for all kinds of stuff in those buildings, but they just print tractors.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Regarding the sandblaster, too, I've got a friend that works in Oakland, Oakland, California, doing they clean the bottom of the ships off, right? So the bottom of the ships are like just covered in like nasty like rust and like actual like sea life, like you know, mussels and all kinds of crap attaches to the bottom of these boats, and they have to clean this stuff off. So they pull them out of the water, and they sandblast the bottom of these boats to get all the nasty sea life off, and then also the rust and whatnot, and then they repaint it, and then, you know, it goes back in the water. But he was talking about exactly the same thing, that if you let go of one of those huge like industrial sandblasters and it gets away, it can kill somebody. It'll take off all the skin off of your arm, type of thing. Like if it hit your arm, it just kind of swings by. Yeah, pretty wild stuff, man. I appreciate you calling. Good stuff as usual. Joseph in Iowa, appreciate it, bro. What else you got real quick? As you know,
I'll add in real quick. I did hear one time that like towns like this, or any town, like, I mean, other countries know about it for strategical reasons. This could, like, if you're talking about living in the safest place, like, this might be safe for crime wise, but you're talking about like war wise, like, this is one of the first, like, some of these small towns with these giant factories are the first places to get hit in war, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, I heard this from my grandpa before.
Yeah, it depends, right? They're doing some of this stuff over in Russia and in Ukraine with the Russia, that invasion and whatnot. You know, it's interesting, some of the strategic points they're trying to take. And it, one of them even is they took Chernobyl, that nuclear factory that had the meltdown. I mean,
I don't understand that. Like, what are they afraid of? Dirty bomb? I immediately thought they're afraid of like a dirty bomb or something. Like, because Chernobyl would have to be just full of radiation and stuff they could use to go against them.
Exactly. Yeah. I don't know. You got me. I'm gonna keep on trucking here. We got to finish this up. You're the best, Joseph. I'll talk to you tonight if you got some time. Have a great one, bro. Joseph here has a YouTube channel called Hydro Host. Check it out. Links in the description down below. All right, let's roll. Let's keep on trucking. I appreciate that adding on to the John Deere stuff. Let's go to, where were we? About to take a break, I think. Yeah, so let's get a quick word from our sponsor, which is you, and we'll be right back with the last segment of Troubled Minds News, and I'm Michael Strange. Don't go anywhere. Be right back.
Are you digging the show? If so, you can support us quite easily and at no additional cost to you if you already have an Amazon Prime account. Since we stream on Twitch every day, all you have to do is link your Amazon Prime account to your Twitch account, and they give you free games on a monthly basis for your personal use, and also a bonus $5 a month to send to your favorite streamer as a way to bring more people to Twitch. And all you have to do is sync up the two accounts and click subscribe. Thanks for considering us.
All right, let's keep on trucking. We got more. Let's go to the Washington Post, the Washington Compost. Democracy dies in darkness. Dun, dun, dun. Check this out. This one's interesting. We've heard all the GMO mosquitoes they're releasing. What about this? The tick that makes people allergic to red meat is in D.C. This is interesting. Our recent weather, warm weather, has reawakened ticks, and one type in particular is becoming more common in the D.C. area, the Lone Star tick. One bite from this tick, which is easily identified by the white spot on its back if it's a female, can cause a lifelong adverse reaction to eating red meat. Excuse me? I mean, what? Really? Lifelong adverse reaction to eating red meat. The Lone Star tick originated in the southern states, but has spread north and west to cover much of the eastern half of the country. With a warming climate, more ticks survive the winter months, and their range is expanding. There you go. That's how it ends, guys. This is how it ends. Until the black-legged deer tick, unlike the black-legged deer tick, the Lone Star tick doesn't transmit Lyme disease, but it can produce a severe food allergy in people known as alpha-gal syndrome, which is an allergy to red meat. When Lone Star ticks feed on mammals such as mice, rabbits, or deer, they ingest alpha-gal sugars. Later, if the tick bites and feeds on humans, they inject the alpha-gal sugars with their saliva into the human host. Because people don't have alpha-gal in their bodies, that's alpha-G-A-L. So I'm not saying it like alpha-gal, but I mean it's alpha-gal. So the human immune system recognizes this alpha-gal from a tick bite as a foreign substance and mounts a response, including the development of antibodies. Often the bite site becomes swollen and itchy. But red meat, which does contain alpha-gal sugars, can further trigger reactions. If red meat is eaten by people bitten by the Lone Star tick, the immune system recognizes the alpha-gal from the meat as a foreign substance. As a result, the body mounts a response, often much more severe than the initial response to the tick bite. WTF? What is this? We were talking about eating crickets not that long ago. We want some Lone Star ticks with your crickets? Robert says, DARPA genetically created these ticks so that people will have to eat bugs. That's exactly what I was thinking when I read this. I was like, I wonder if this is not a natural phenomenon. It seems a little bit, let's say, science fiction. How about that? It definitely seems science fiction. So I thought we'd add it to the news today. Why not, right? Let's keep on trucking. There's always more news. Hashtag feminism. This is feminism for today, folks. NASA, this is from Gizmodo. NASA is sending artificial female bodies to the moon to study radiation risks. Hey, who says things aren't equal? Come on. Helga and Zohar are headed for a trip around the moon on an important mission, measuring radiation risks for female astronauts for the first time. All right. So we're going to sacrifice these poor mannequins. The inanimate pair are mannequins modeled after the body of an adult woman. For the Artemis 1 mission, in which an uncrewed Orion capsule will travel to the moon and back, one of the mannequins will be outfitted with a newly developed radiation protection vest. Helga and Zohar, as they're called, won't be alone, as they'll be joined by a third mannequin that will collect data about flight accelerations and vibrations. Artemis 1 is scheduled to blast off later this year. All right, well, that's fine. Helga and Zohar. That sounds very, I don't know, what would you call it? Very something. Very, anyway. Here's a photograph of these the two torsos prior to transport. And indeed, indeed, these mannequins seem to have breasts. There you go. Quote, we are looking to find out exactly how radiation levels affect female astronauts over the course of an entire flight to the moon, and which protective measures might help to counteract this. Thomas Berger, head of the biophysics group in the radiation and biology department at the DLR Institute of Aerospace Medicine, said in a statement. Here's how it will work. The mannequins are made from materials that mimic the bones, soft tissues, and organs of an adult woman, all of which will be tracked by more than 10,000 passive sensors and 34 active radiation detectors, according to DLR. One of the mannequins, Helga, will fly to the moon unprotected. Aw, that's messed up. While the other one, Zohar, will wear a radiation protection vest called the Astrorad, which was developed by American aerospace company Lockheed Martin and Israeli startup Stemrad. Of course, Lockheed Martin has to rear its ugly head and make an appearance. Give me one sec. My dog's freaking out. I'm going to make sure everything's okay. Be right back. Don't go anywhere. More Troubled Minds on the way. Got a couple more, and we'll finish this up. Be right back. Thanks for your patience. Everything's fine. Just barking at the neighbors like dogs are common to do. All right. What do you guys think? This is good stuff, right? Poor Helga is going to get irradiated while Zohar's protected. There you go. What do you think? Robert says, hey, guys, watch out for those artificial women, if you know what I mean. All right. Look at this one. Remember, we've been talking about this. We've been speculating this. This has been widely speculated the world over. But wouldn't you know it? Putin to undergo cancer surgery. Transfer power to ex-FSB chief per report. Damn dog is still out there losing her mind. Okay. This is what they were saying, right? It's kind of been rumored, whispered for weeks or even months now that there's something significantly wrong with Vladimir Putin, right? And let's see. Let's read this. Russian President Vladimir Putin is set to undergo cancer surgery and temporarily hand over power to a hardline former federal police chief, according to a new report. Putin will transfer control of Russia's government to Nikolai Patrushev, head of the Russian Federal Police's Security Council, while he is incapacitated during and after the procedure, according to a video from the mysterious Telegram channel General SVR on Saturday. All right, so is this fake? What is this? The channel, which is purportedly run by a former Russian Foreign Intelligence Service Lieutenant General known by the pseudonym Viktor Mikhailovich, reported that Putin has been told by doctors that he must undergo an operation. The anticipated surgery and recovery are expected to incapacitate Putin for a short time, according to the unconfirmed report. Interesting. Quote, Putin is unlikely to agree to hand over power for a longer period of time, the narrator of the video states, adding that the control of the country will likely be in Putrashev's hands for no more than 2 to 3 days. Quote, I will say this is the worst option, the narrator adds. Putrashev is an outright villain. He is no better than Vladimir Putin. Blah, blah. Anyway, interesting. This was, hopefully this is not, I don't know. What would you say? Like, yeah, you know, you hate for terrible things to happen to anybody. Do you say good health to Vladimir Putin, or does that bring the mob down on you? I don't know. It's pretty weird, right? Derek says, isn't this exactly what happened to Biden when Harris took over for the day? Maybe, right? I can't remember exactly what happened there. Robert says, Nikolai will make sure Putin doesn't survive the surgery. Yeah, I was wondering about that. So if he's like super into his security, right, and everybody's, you know, I mean, everybody in the West, of course, is kind of keen to take this guy out. I'm not so sure everybody in Russia is, and, you know, would expect him to be on a serious lockdown mode while he's incapacitated. So I don't know. I mean, this is one of those weird ones. Is this true? It's again, you know, reported by the New York Post, and they cite this other like Telegram channel. So who knows if this is real or if it's not real. But what's up, June Sunachi? He's not going along with the WEF agenda, so they'll clone him. Oh, there you go. Maybe it's a cloning procedure. Yeah, there you go. Why not? Why the hell not? This is Troubled Minds after all. All right, one more, and let's get the hell out of here. Speaking of old age and all the rest of that stuff we were talking about with magnetism and your demeanor and all the rest of it affecting your cognitive into your middle age years. Well, SciTech Daily says that they have a new study regarding how much actual sleep you need as a middle-aged person. Something near and dear to my heart, sleep. I get some sometimes. Researchers from the University of Cambridge and Fudan University say 7 hours is the ideal amount of sleep for people in their middle age and upwards, with too little or too much sleep associated with poorer cognitive performance and mental health. In a research published April 28th, 2022, in a scientific journal, Nature Aging, scientists from the UK and China examined data from nearly 500,000 adults aged 38 to 73. From the UK Biobank. Oh, that sounds fine. The UK Biobank. What the hell does that mean? Participants were asked about their sleeping patterns, mental health, and well-being, and took part in a series of cognitive tests. Brain imaging and genetic data were available for almost 40,000 of the study participants. Interesting. That would be your UK Biobank, I guess. By analyzing the data, the team found that both sufficient and excessive sleep during duration were associated with impaired cognitive performance, such as processing speed, visual attention, memory, and problem-solving skills. 7 hours of sleep per night was the optimal amount of sleep for cognitive performance, but also good for mental health, with people experiencing more symptoms of anxiety and depression and worse overall well-being if they reported sleeping for longer or shorter durations. There you go. 7 hours. Get it for you middle-aged types out there. If you're older than that or younger than that, well, get it anyway. You need your rest. There's Michael Strange is not a doctor, but take it to the bank. You need your rest. All right. Okay. We're about done here. What we're going to do is we'll be back in about 3 hours. Let's say 3 hours. A little over 3 hours or a little under 3 hours for Troubled Minds Radio. That's coming up tonight at 7 p.m. Pacific. I don't know exactly what I'm going to talk about. Any ideas? Throw them my way. I do. I have an idea. I just came up with an idea. You see how that happens? You're like, now I got an idea. And so I do have an idea. It doesn't have anything to do with this stuff. I got an idea from another idea that I just had. And, well, that's the way things go. So love to hear your thoughts tonight on the other idea as we get there. But for now, what we're going to do is say thank you. Thanks for being I'm going to say thank you for being part of this. Thanks for spending your time and energy here. Thanks for listening and understanding and caring and all the rest of that stuff. There we go. And what we're going to do is also say thank you to all the folks who have subbed up to Twitch, to Rockfin, to Patreon, to listening to the podcast feed, which are the ways you can help support the show. Thank you to all the fine folks who have purchased merchandise from troubledfans.com. That's another one that's up, and I was selling hats over there, and we got some hats and pictures. People sending me pictures about their Troubled Minds hat that just came in, so I appreciate that. Thanks, guys. And if you want to help the show, spread the word. Easiest old-fashioned way to do it, spread the word and listen to the podcast feed. That would be iTunes, that would be Spotify, that would be anywhere you find your podcast. It's completely free, and just listen to some old shows. As of right now, there are exactly 400 shows, 400 back on the podcast feed. So I'm sure most of you haven't heard all of them. I'm probably the only person out there that's heard all of them, because I've been here for all of them. And there you go. So tons of good stuff. If you haven't checked it out, go check it out. And maybe put on an old show while you're cooking dinner over the weekend or something. That would be the way to do it. And just let those commercials play. Please don't fast forward those commercials. It knows when you do. There you go. All right. So let's get the hell out of here. Thanks again for being part of this. Thanks for hanging out. You guys are all the best. We'll be back 3 hours from now for Troubled Minds Radio. Have a fantastic afternoon. We'll see you shortly.